Good evening, everybody. This is Mark Patterson. I'm talking to you from the world's only underwater laboratory, Aquarius. I'm 20,000 millimeters under the sea off the coast of Florida, and this is Project SeaCAMEL. SeaCAMEL is a educational project of the Living Oceans Foundation. Living Oceans Foundation is a not-for-profit organization dedicated to marine science and research with a special emphasis on coral reefs. And this is the second of six broadcasts that we're doing at the college university level on marine biology and physics from Aquarius, which is America's inner space station, operated by NOAA, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. Tonight we got a very interesting classroom module for you. It's called The Reef at Night, and we're going to see what marvelous changes happen biologically out on the reef and take a look at some of the changes that took place from what we saw earlier today when we did a broadcast about Aquarius as an engineering structure. And I wanted to invite everybody that's listening to come back tomorrow at 11 o'clock when we do a module on corals and some of the challenges that coral reefs worldwide are facing. And then we've got another module in the afternoon on sponges, the reef's filters, and that's going to be at 2 o'clock. And then Wednesday, we'll do a module again at 11 o'clock in the morning, Eastern Standard Time, on the physics of flow, motion in the ocean over conch reef, how water moving past the corals out here affects all aspects of their biology. And then we'll wrap things up at 2 o'clock on Wednesday. That's 2 p.m. EST. We'll be looking at Aquarius as an artificial reef and some of the new high-tech tools that are used to help assess fish, to count fish. And tonight I think we'll see a lot of fish. I'm looking out the window right now, and I'll move the camera here in a couple minutes and let you see what I see out this wonderful viewport here. Tonight's show is going to be very interesting because not only are we going to look at what's going on at the reef at night, but we're going to use some new technology to let us see some things that are impossible to see with the naked human eye. We're going to be using a night sea fluorescent system that's going to show us fluorescence, which we'll explain a little later in the classroom. Fluorescence is an interesting process, and it results in some very beautiful imagery, but it's also a new tool for coral scientists to use, and we'll explain how that is used later when we go out to our aquanauts outside. I'd like to explain a little bit about the anatomy of one of the most important organisms out on a coral reef, and that's the corals themselves. So we have an image that I'd like our folks ashore to put up on the web for you to take a look at here. This is a public domain image that NOAA has in their library, and it shows a picture of a single coral polyp. Now, a coral polyp is the individual unit of a colonial organism, and we're going to take a look at corals and what they do at night. I've actually got a dead coral colony here that was collected from the reef a couple of years ago and used. It was actually alive when we used it. We used it several years in a row in some experiments. So this is a coral skeleton, and the diagram that you saw before showed what an individual feeding unit of this colonial organism looks like, and that little umbrella-shaped structure is the feeding unit. There's a tentacular crown on the polyp that's used to catch zooplankton. Tonight we're going to see zooplankton out in the reef, and we'll explain a little later what zooplankton are and why the reef changes so drastically from day to night with how much plankton are floating by in the water for the corals to eat. At this point, I'd like to introduce my two fellow aquanauts, actually three, out in the water column. We're going to go to two of them out near the bow of Aquarius. The divers in the water column are Dr. Annalise Hagen. She is the chief project scientist of the Living Oceans Foundation, and Captain Philip Renault. He's the executive director of the Living Oceans Foundation, and they're being ably filmed by DJ Roller of Liquid Pictures, our cinematographer. I think they're probably up at the bow now, and they're going to. Annalise is going to show you a little bit more about the biology of a very showy coral here at Conch Reef. It's called Monastria cavernosa. So, Annalise, if you can hear me, why don't you say hi and tell us a little bit about the biology of corals in general. Thanks, Annalise. That was great. One thing that happens at night on a coral reef is that all sorts of tiny animals emerge from the crevices and cracks on the reef and come swimming up in the water column. And these tiny animals drift with the current, so they're called plankton. They're called zooplankton because zoo means animal. And this animal plankton is distinct from the zooplankton that you might see out in the middle of the ocean, which is there all the time. This demersal zooplankton is only up there at night on a coral reef. We've got a movie of demersal zooplankton. It was actually a little clip taken in Jamaica. And one interesting thing about the zooplankton is they're attracted to a dive light. That means they're also attracted to moonlight or starlight at the surface of the sea. So when they emerge from the sediments or the corals, they start heading upwards towards slightly brighter light. So if you're underwater and you've got a dive light, they're going to be attracted to that light, and we'll show you that phenomenon in a second. I forgot to mention when I introduced the show that this educational outreach is involving graduate students and undergraduates at numerous universities, but in particular from my home institution. I've got a crack team of surf knots, as we call them, some of whom are divers, and they were out here earlier today at Conch Reef, and they kindly installed some plankton traps that we're going to take a look at in a few minutes. One interesting thing that's been found about these plankton upon which the corals feed at night is that corals that are able to eat lots of these plankton do better when a bleaching event takes place. Annalise mentioned that there are symbiotic algae that live inside the corals that help feed them during the day. And now that we've got global warming heating the planet up, these episodes where the algae are stressed and are expelled from the coral are becoming more and more frequent. And if you return tomorrow during our module on corals, we're going to talk a lot more about this phenomenon of coral bleaching. But recently, a scientist at Ohio State University, Andrea Grottoli, who's actually a veteran aquanaut down here at Aquarius, discovered that corals that feed on zooplankton well are actually able to weather bleaching events and survive them and recover from them better than corals that aren't as good at catching zooplankton. So one thing that my students wanted to do was to see, well, what's the demersal zooplankton like at Conch Reef? So they built these traps, which you're going to see in a couple of minutes. So at this point, I'd like to toss it back to Annalise and see, Annalise, could you bring a dive light close to that Monastria cavernosa colony and see if we can't get it to feed?
Thanks, Mark. I've been holding my light here now for a few minutes, trying to attract the demersal zooplankton, so hopefully we might see some feeding behavior. You can see that some of the tentacles are still extended. And the corals have specialized adapted cells called cnidocytes. And these have barbs shot out with venom. And these are called nematocysts. And once the prey is paralyzed by these nematocysts, the tentacles bring in the prey into the stomach sac of the coral. And this is called the cilenteron. I'm hoping DJ is picking up some of this zooplankton activity that we have here. Mark, how's the zooplankton looking out of the viewport?
Well, thanks, Annalise. Actually, there's lots of activity up here. I would pick up the camera and do a close-up, but probably it'll be better if DJ does it later when we go to the plankton traps. But if you're looking at the view here, you see in the background that there are some chubs. This is a herbivorous, zooplanktivorous fish named Kyphosis sectatrix, and we've got a big swarm of them that have been attracted to the lights near the habitat. And the reason they're here near the lights is that response of the demersal zooplankton to be attracted to light has brought quite a swarm up here. I see, looking out the window, larvae of crustaceans. I see little segmented worms called polychaetes. I see some miniature crustaceans called copepods. Some of them are flashing lights at me as I look through the window. So we've got quite a soup here, and the chubs are actually having quite a feeding frenzy outside. One thing I wanted to mention about corals is that even though they have plants inside them and photosynthesize, they are animals. And because they're animals, they actually are capable of movement. You actually probably saw some of the tentacles moving as Annalise brought the dive light and the zooplankton were attracted to it and were being stung by the tentacles. There's also a primitive nerve net that cnidarians, which is the phylum in which corals belong. Cnidarians do have a primitive nerve net. And we're actually going to have Annalise demonstrate this in a second. Annalise, if you haven't already fed that colony to where it's full, maybe you could show us with a new colony what happens when you touch a coral, and explain why, in general, we don't want to touch corals, but we're going to do a little experiment where we gently touch them tonight.
Thanks, Mark. I actually moved away from that colony because it had retracted its tentacles. I've since found another one, but that also has its tentacles retracted. So we might have to swim for a couple of minutes just to find a coral that is actively feeding at the moment.
Annalise, if you see another species of coral with its polyps out and that one works, just give me a shout and I'll toss it back to you.
Mark, I found a great one here.
Okay, go ahead. Seeing.
Of a Montastria cavernosa feeding. All its tentacles are extended. What I'm going to do is very carefully touch just one of the polyps, and you will see that its tentacles will retract. Normally you holding them, and by touching them, you break this layer and can introduce bacteria. But you can also see, if you touch a couple of polyps, that sets off a wave of reaction, and now the entire colony has retracted its polyps. And this is a defensive mechanism.
One question I get from my friends and relatives and even my students is when they see pictures of a coral reef, they notice that the corals come in a variety of shapes and sizes, of course, but they also come in many different colors. Corals are often a chocolatey green color or a dark brown color or sometimes a orange color. And that leads us to the subject of pigments in corals. Now, one of pigment, of course, is the pigment that's central to life on Earth, and that's the chlorophyll molecule that's found in the symbiotic algae that live inside the coral, the zooxanthellae. And indeed, part of the color that we see when we look at a coral is due to the algae themselves. But there are also animal pigments in the coral, and some of these have a function. Some of them are actually, believe it or not, sunscreens. These chemical compounds are found in corals that live in shallower water to protect them from ultraviolet light, which can damage their DNA. Recently, some technology has been developed to take advantage of the fact that many of these invertebrates have giant fluorescent proteins, or GFPs for short. And one such company that makes a product that we're using tonight was developed by a scientist who's an expert on fluorescence, is a NITESE system. How does fluorescence work? Well, if you possess a protein that emits the strong fluorescence, what happens is that if you excite the protein molecule with light of short enough wavelength. In this case, we're going to be using a high-intensity blue light. So each of the particles of light, each of the photons, has lots and lots of energy. And as the photon blasts by one of these giant fluorescent protein pigment molecules, it causes the electrons in the protein to become excited, and they move a little bit further away from the molecule. And then something interesting happens. As those electrons decay back to their base orbit in the structure of the molecule, they emit light. And that light is a longer wavelength than the wavelength of the photon of light that excited them in the first place. So if we're shining high-intensity blue light on these pigments, they will emit light in, say, the green or yellow or orange or red spectrum. Now, to see that, we have to use a filter, because if we're shining a blue light on something and we don't use a filter, it, of course, is going to look blue to us. So we've got filters that cut off the blue light. And I'm going to ask Phil Renault, who's executive director and out there with Annalise as her dive buddy, to tell us a little bit about what this gear looks like. It's actually quite simple. And then after Phil's explained what the gear looks like and shown it to us, Annalise, let's go prospecting for some interesting fluorescence patterns of some of the marvelous invertebrates out there on Conch Reef. So go ahead, Phil, and tell us about the NITESE system.
Well, good evening, everyone. I'm carrying just a high-intensity blue light, and then I'm wearing a filter on my dive mask. And it allows me to see the fluorescence that the coral's putting out. And I found an interesting example right here. It's difficult for me to tell. I think this is another Montastria colony. And it looks like there's a lot of fluorescence on this particular colony. I'm looking around the reef now for other examples. I can see a lot of red light coming off different species.
One thing that's very interesting about this light system is that scientists are using it to look at coral recruitment on the reef. Coral recruits are so small sometimes. They're very difficult to see. But by using this light system, they shine up as like as fluorescent spots on the substrate. So recruitment can be recorded more easily. Now Mark told us about the demersal zooplankton that come out at night. And many, many organisms take advantage of this. Size of the habitat. They make an incredible, almost carpet-like feature. We're hoping also to see some predation. We saw a lot of barracuda during the day today, and at night they'll be hunting on smaller fish. So we're keeping our eyes out to hopefully be able to show you some fun hunting activity later. So here we are outside the bunk room, on the outside of the habitat. And you can see how incredible this sight is. And this you really can't see during the day. All these tentacles just come alive at night as everyone's feeding on the demersal zooplankton. If we zoom in here as well, we can see these little worms. And they're called Christmas tree worms because they look like a Christmas tree. And they also have a defensive mechanism like the coral tentacles. And if I wave my hand above them, we can see that they also retract.
It's actually been discovered recently, a couple of years ago, that some of the motile, that is, organisms able to move around on the reef, can also show fluorescence. And one of the creatures that does this is a stomatopod. A stomatopod is a kind of a crustacean. Another name for it is a mantis shrimp. And we've got a little movie here from the Night Sea website showing a very interesting fluorescence on this crustacean. Now, this crustacean makes a burrow from which it ambushes prey. And it's got two fluorescent dots on its appendages up front that it uses to catch food and also compete with other members of its species for space. And there was an interesting paper that came out in a top science journal by the scientists that discovered this fluorescent pigment in these stomatopods, and they actually showed that this fluorescent signal was actually visible to the other members of its species. So it was using these fluorescent dots as a way to signal and say, hey, I'm bigger and badder than you, and thus you should stay away from me. At this point, I'd actually like Annalise and Phil, if you could start moving towards the plankton nets that the students put out. One thing that the students were interested in determining was whether or not different kinds of bottom type here produced differing amounts of demersal zooplankton. So they set out nets on a sandy bottom, and they put out some nets on the bottom that had a little bit of coral cover. And they put another net out on one that didn't have as much coral cover, but maybe had some more sponges and other invertebrates. We're going to be changing out the jars in which the zooplankton are caught every day for the next 3 days. and do a little pilot study here about how much zooplankton is actually produced each night and what are the different kinds of organisms that we catch. So we're hoping that we've got something in those traps. Now, bear in mind that the sun just went down a couple of hours ago here in Florida, and the demersal zooplankton will take, they'll be coming out of the reef all night long. In fact, one of the interesting things I like about living underwater is just watching how much the plankton change throughout the evening. So you get an interesting ebb and flow with the show out the window here changing quite drastically.
There are three plankton gnats here. The one we're at now is over the reef. So this is essentially over a substrate of sponges and corals and macroalgae. So if we can look in the jar, and let's see if we can find any zooplankton that's been caught by the net. The nets have been constructed in this funnel shape so that as the plankton rise up off the reef at night, they're caught in this bottleneck and then they're trapped in the jar. So when the students come and collect the jar tomorrow morning, there won't be any ability for the zooplankton to escape. And also, when the traps are changed, they'll squeeze up the netting so that any of the plankton trapped in the base of the netting will be funneled into the jar here. I'm not sure if you'll be able to see any of the specimens inside the jar, but I think my light's causing quite a lot of activity. So here we have one net on the reef itself, and then on the sand, there's another net, and there's a third net over some rubbly sand area. There you go, Mark.
I promised earlier in the classroom to tell you how this technology is used by coral reef scientists. Baby corals, when they settle out of the plankton themselves, actually fluoresce quite brightly. So this technology has been used to go find individual single coral polyps just after they've settled out of the plankton. So a scientist wearing the gear, like you've seen Annalise and Phil wear tonight, could actually do a census out in the dark of the seafloor and see how many new baby corals there are in a given system. Now, why would they be concerned with that? As coral reefs come under increasing environmental stressors, one thing that coral scientists are trying to figure out is how fast can new individuals come into a population and potentially grow up to be adult colonies. Now, this takes quite a long time, but it's very important to know at the juvenile stage how many we've got, and that's where this technology is very, very useful. I think at this stage, I'd like to invite Annalise and Phil to come over to the main lock window. And one individual organism that comes out at night that's quite showy and also fluoresces quite well is one that we as aquanauts during our safety briefings were told to avoid. It's called a bristle worm, and it's a polychaete. And it's got little bristles on each of its segmented body parts. The ceti is a technical name for these bristles. And they can break off into your skin if you touch this worm, and they sting like getting fiberglass shards in your finger. And there's also a toxin involved. This could be a mission-ending event for us. And it's at night that this polychaete called Hermandice carunculata comes out and moves around on the top of the habitat and on the sides. So we'll have you folks come over and take a look with your fluorescent lights and see if you see any Hermandice. The other thing I was going to invite you to do was give our audience out there a shot of what the predator show looks like. We've got the whole food chain spinning up here in the water column right in front of my window, and you might be able to catch the entire food chain in action. Oh, it looks like we've got a special treat. I see one of the aquanauts has found an amazing suspension feeding organism here. So, DJ, if you could get some footage of this. This is an amazing ophiuroid. It's an echinoderm. It's in the phylum Echinodermata. And this is called a basket star. And this particular species, I believe, is Astrophyton muricatum. And it's just an amazing, amazing organism. You can see that it's got hundreds and hundreds of arms. They look like tendrils, and they're all moving around, and they're capturing zooplankton. So this is a suspension feeding organism, just like the corals and just like the sponges that you saw on the outside of the habitat. And this is one of my favorites because it hides during the day and comes out at night and expands its arms in this really just amazing spectacle. And so I've spent a lot of time when I've been diving at night admiring this organism. And while I talked about this in the first classroom we had earlier in the day about Aquarius as a system, I thought I'd close by explaining why we have an inner space station here, why this is a good use of U.S. taxpayers' dollars to advance the cause of ocean science. If you're a scuba diver and you're trying to work out of a boat from the surface, those of you who know how to scuba dive know that you might only be able to spend 1 to 2 hours a day diving, and then you're done. So if you're trying to study the underwater world using scuba diving as a technique, you don't get a lot of work done per day. If you come to a place like Aquarius and come into the habitat, within a matter of hours, your body has absorbed all the nitrogen it's ever going to. And now you can spend a lot of time in the water column and not have to worry about decompression and getting sick from the nitrogen causing bubbles if you come up too quickly to the surface, because you don't go back to the surface. This is your home for anywhere from 5 days to maybe as long as 16 days. And during that time that you're here, you can spend maybe 8 hours a day out in the water column working. So you can put in a full work day underwater by using this high-tech tool. So it gives us a lot of bottom time, as is referred to by divers. That means we can get a lot of work done. If I bring a team of 4 scientists inside Aquarius, I can get done in 10 days what might take me 6 months if I were diving from a small boat. Another reason we like to use the habitat is we can do experiments here that we could not do very easily back in a laboratory or diving out of a small boat. Part of my fascination with the ocean world has been how motion in the ocean, that is the movement of waves and currents over the marine life, affects their basic biology. And I've been able to do some careful experiments here at the habitat using apparatus that I and my students have built. And we actually plug these gizmos into the power that we have out here. And then we actually use the computers that are here inside the habitat to monitor those experiments. So those are 2 reasons why Aquarius is such a useful tool. It allows you to spend lots of time on the seafloor and allows you to do experiments that you could never do any other way. So I'd like to thank everybody that's joined us for our second classroom from the bottom of the sea. We hope you've enjoyed it. And we invite you to tune in and check out both the Living Ocean Foundation website and the NOAA Aquarius website. So thanks, everybody. And going to say goodbye to Annalise and Phil outside here. Thanks, guys. You did a great job tonight. Bye-bye.
Thank you.